What's going on, Pixar fans? Ryan O'Toole back here again, giving you guys another ranking. If you guys are new here, feel free to click that subscribe button and that bell notification icon for more reviews, reactions, rankings, and more movie content. With the release of Luca, Pixar's newest film, coming only to Disney Plus this weekend, it's time to stop and rank all 24 Pixar movies with Luca from worst to best. Before I give you guys my ranking for the Pixar films, let me know what your updated ranking for the Pixar movies are down below in the comment section. Pixar is a beloved film studio. Fans are so passionate about Pixar, they will get really angry if their favorite Pixar movie isn't higher on your list. And that is what I'm warning with you guys. This is my list. This is my opinion. Know that going in. Please be respectful of other people's opinions, guys. That is what the comment section is for. Understand that film is subjective. The art of film is like anything. We can watch a movie, we can either love it or hate it, find it overrated. That's what the beauty of film is. Be friendly, respect each other's opinions. Without further ado, let's get started. Did you guys expect any other film was going to be my least favorite Pixar film other than Cars 2? If you've been watching my channel for many years, I've done many Pixar rankings. Cars 2 has always been at the bottom for me. This movie is a cash grab moneymaker. It didn't really focus at all on being a compelling Pixar movie. I don't understand what the filmmakers were going through in their heads, thinking that Mater would be a compelling lead character over Lightning McQueen. This World Grand Prix concept sounds really fun and interesting, but instead you have Mater becoming a spy like James Bond out of left field for no reason. He has no idea what he's doing, just walks into a bathroom, and now he's the next James Bond.
Follow our hearts and find love.
Brave, I think, is a very creative Pixar film, but I call Brave the black sheep for Pixar. What do I mean by the black sheep for Pixar? I mean that one Pixar movie I either forget is a Pixar film or doesn't feel or look like a Pixar film. I didn't really like that Merida was such a brat in the first act of this movie, and to solve her conflict, she turns her mother into a bear just because she can't inherit what her mother is coming from. I understand you want to be a rebel, but you overact in certain scenes, but I do think Merida becomes a good Pixar character within the third act of the film. The mother-daughter storyline in this movie, I think, is a different approach, and I respect that for Pixar. The animation in this film is really good, and I do appreciate Pixar for tackling something different, but it does dive into story elements that we may have seen before. Just like Brave, I also kind of think of The Good Dinosaur as kind of a black sheep for Pixar. I always sometimes forget that The Good Dinosaur is a Pixar film. The photorealistic settings of this movie look totally mind-blowing. They look realistic. You're watching these animated design characters walking in real forests, a real river, real waterfall. But I think the way the characters are designed are very lackluster and kind of eh. And you have our lead characters in Arlo and Spot. Arlo has a very similar character arc to Simba in The Lion King. Loses his daddy-o and he has to learn how to become a better version of himself, become a man dinosaur, meets Spot and really has a great relationship with Spot. It's a coming of age story we've seen before. Good Dinosaur could have been great, but it's just turns out into an eh movie.
On this track.
Yes, I do.
I was not looking forward to Cars 3 at all going into it. As soon as I heard they're making a Cars 3, I'm like, why not Incredibles 2? Where the hell is Incredibles 2? Why are we getting a Cars 3? I thought the first two were completely different. The first one's enjoyable at times. The second one's not good. This one turned out to be decent. I do find Cars 3 just a decent movie. I do like that Lightning McQueen is older now and people are telling him to retire. All these new rookies are completely taking over the league, including Jackson Storm, who's this high-tech race car that is super fast and Lightning can't even catch him. And his new trainer with Cruz Ramirez, who becomes a very interesting character in the final act. I wish this movie focused more on the certain Doc Hudson storyline. I do appreciate they brought back Doc Hudson in this movie, and Cars 2, they completely wept out Doc Hudson at all. This one, I think, was at its best when it was at the Doc Hudson storyline. I didn't grow up with the Cars movies. I was around 10, 11. I didn't grow up with them, but I was a kid, kind of, when these movies came out. The first Cars movie I do really love when I was a kid. I collected the Cars toys, believe it or not, when I was a kid. But now, as an adult, it's fun. It's a fine movie. I think the first Cars is decent. I like the character arc Lightning McQueen goes on. He's this cocky rookie at the start. He's very selfish. His crew, pit crew, finds him very selfish and fires them. And I do love that Lightning becomes a better car and meets Mater, his best friend. Mater was kind of annoying in this movie, let's be real. Sally is probably the most wasted character in this franchise. They really don't do much with Sally at all. But the best character in the first Cars is Doc Hudson, played by Paul Newman. Doc Hudson was a very compelling character. Wish we could have got a lot more of him, Doc and Lightning's relationship.
Next up, Sullivan and Boggs.
Monsters University, definitely one of the more unnecessary Pixar films. Like, I think we all wanted a sequel to Monsters, Inc. Thank goodness we're getting that Monsters at Work on Disney Plus this year. But there's so much you could do with this world of Monsters, Inc. Monsters going into kids' bedrooms and using their screams to run a company. Like, that is a very interesting storyline. I do like that Mike's the main character in here, and Mike becomes this compelling character we're rooting for. And Sully as well is not a perfect character at all. He cheats at the end just to help his buddy Mike. And it does have a pretty intimidating character with Helen Mirren as Dean Hardscrabble. But again, Monsters University, I didn't want a college movie with Mike and Sully meeting and other fraternities battling other fraternities, jocks versus the nerds. Finding Dory, I have mixed feelings on. It definitely feels unnecessary, but I do respect Finding Dory for its ambition. I was looking forward to it going in. I'm such a massive fan of Finding Nemo. I'll talk about that film later. Dory definitely has an arc in this movie, overcoming her short-term memory loss, discovering that she had parents, and she's doing anything possible to find them in California at this aquarium. Now, that does feel very anticlimactic and kind of eh that it just takes place at this aquarium. Because if you look at the first Finding Nemo, that was a full-out adventure throughout the sea. But I do like the side characters in here, especially Hank. Hank was a very cool character, really cool introduction to him. I also love the seals that are on the rock. One of them is Idris Elba. Get off this rock, 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 rock. They were pretty funny. Alright, now we're getting our first hot take out of the way. I always get slandered and ripped to shreds for having this opinion, but it is my opinion. WALL-E, I think, is the most overrated Pixar film. The first act of this movie is a masterpiece. The first act is great. The first 30 minutes. You could have taken that first 30 minutes and made into an epic Pixar short. It would be the best Pixar short out of all of them, easily. But then it goes on the Axiom ship, and with the fat people storyline, that's where the movie kind of went downhill for me, from not calling it a masterpiece. It's these two robots. You see these characters, really no dialogue at all, forming this great relationship. Well, I understand the messages that this could potentially be Earth in the next 10 to 20 years. However, I don't think of rewatchable Pixar as when I think of WALL-E. Every time I watch WALL-E, I get kind of bored sometimes. I respect your opinion, but top 5 Pixar? That's not me.
Does this mean Woody's a lost toy?
He's not lost. Not anymore. To infinity and beyond.
Oh my god, I'm gonna get absolutely destroyed by people in the comments for these next two takes. Toy Story 4 has dropped to number 16 on my Pixar ranking. And for good reasons, for good reasons. Now, when I first saw Toy Story 4 in the theaters, or going into it, I was very nervous, very concerned. I'm like, Toy Story 3 was the absolute perfect ending. Why are they making a Toy Story 4? And I've seen Toy Story 4 about 5 times now, and my enjoyment has definitely gone down every rewatch. It is a good movie. I do love that this is Woody's story. It's Ed and Woody's storyline in here with him and Bo Peep. But my biggest issue with Toy Story 4, if they made it, is I didn't like what they did with Buzz in this movie. Buzz Lightyear was a pretty dumb, pointless character in here. I didn't like the different futures they added to his character when he presses his button. He uses that button for everything. Like, that wasn't Buzz Lightyear in the original trilogy. Buzz always had a complete perfect plan, just like Woody. While I don't think the ending of this movie was as emotionally impactful as I was hoping for, it is a sweet ending for Woody's character, and it was better than I expected, for sure. It's not an amazing movie, in my opinion. It is a good, solid movie. Again, I'm definitely getting slandered. I always do for having this opinion, but Ratatouille. Ratatouille is number 15 on my ranking. I know all the Ratatouille fans are revolting at my door right now. I have a very good reason why this isn't higher on my list. I just don't love it like the majority do. The thing I can respect about Ratatouille is Remy as a character. He's a fantastic character. You get his passions, you get what he wants to do, you know why he has a revolt against his family. He's gonna do whatever he wants to do and be a chef at Gusto's restaurant. Well, I just think that this movie is probably the most unrealistic Pixar movie ever to date. Like, a rat inside Linguini's hat controlling him, and then you have this villainous chef voiced by the great Ian Holm, rest in peace. And I didn't really like his character. The family aspects didn't work for me fully. And again, I just don't love the movie as much as a lot of you do. Incredibles 2, the Pixar sequel we have been demanding for 14 years. My goodness, 14 years to make an Incredibles 2. We get 3 Cars movies before this. I think when I first saw this movie, I liked it more than the original. It's definitely not better than the original, but I think it is a really good, really solid Pixar sequel. I love how this movie dives more into superheroes are illegal, and there's this movement started by Winston, Bob Odenkirk, love that. I like Elastigirl is now the one providing for the family, and Mr. Incredible, Bob Parr, is the stay-at-home dad. Jack-Jack steals the entire movie, hands down. Jack-Jack was awesome. Frozone was in it more than I thought he would. Love Frozone. Yes, the twist I totally saw coming the moment I saw this new character, Winston's sister. But I do like the screenslaver's motivations in here, and it is a solid Pixar villain.
Just you!
Good! Now hang on!
It's you, Bruno!
Luca. I just saw Luca, guys. My review is now out on the channel. You can check out my full in-depth thoughts. And I really enjoyed Luca. Another solid film from Pixar. Just a coming-of-age story with these two friends that are also these sea monsters. The animation is beautiful. Just the ocean shots, the city shots. It's just this story about these two friends. They're competing in this little bike tournament thingy, and it's a pretty solid story all around. My in-depth review is out on the channel. All I could say is Luca is another solid Pixar film.
Amazing! Yeah, but just keep going. Don't look back. Just straight ahead.
You still got the rope, right?
Yeah, I got it.
Onward is definitely a fun adventure all around with these elf brothers, and it definitely relates to me having a brother, Cody, and the story in this movie definitely impacted me. Ian and Barley have such a great relationship as brothers in here, with Tom Holland and Chris Pratt as the voices. This is a very underrated Pixar movie, I think is getting too much hate on. I do agree some of the comedy doesn't work and it is a bit awkward looking for a Pixar film, but I just love the emotional aspects, the fun adventure that they go on. It's like this fun Indiana Jones Raiders of the Lost Ark meets the Goonies adventure vibe that I love, man.
So who is the weaker species? Ants don't serve grasshoppers. It's you who need us. We're a lot stronger than you say we are.
This is, I think, the most underrated Pixar movie, and that is their second installment, A Bug's Life. I've always loved this movie. I love the ants' revolution against the grasshoppers. I think that's a compelling and motivational storyline. You got Flick as our lead character in here, who I definitely like Flick as a lead character. And he's just proven to this ant colony that he's right, and he's not a perfect character. And the grasshoppers. Hopper is one of the best Pixar villains to date. The circus bugs are definitely entertaining in here, and I just think the storyline about revolting against any tyranny that you have strong numbers is very inspirational. Before I give you guys my top 10 Pixar movies, if you are enjoying this video and you want to see more ranking or other videos like this, please hit that like button. It really helps this channel a lot, and consider clicking that subscribe button for more movie reviews, ranking videos, and more movie content on this channel on a weekly basis. One of the most original Pixar films to date is Pete Docter's Monsters, Inc. Monsters, Inc. is a classic from Pixar. Once again, the concept of this movie is brilliant. Pete Docter is a genius. Mike and Sully are that iconic duo that you all remember from Pixar. And I think just the storylines in here, the characters are so memorable. Of course, Boo. Boo is the most adorable Pixar character to date. Randall is a very intimidating villain, Steve Buscemi. And Mr. Waternose, probably one of the most disgusting villains I've seen in a while. All around, Monsters, Inc. has a very compelling story.
It's beautiful. Every hour is spent together.
Toy Story 2, one of the most rewatchable Pixar movies for me, one of my favorite sequels. Toy Story 2 is so damn good, guys. I love just the storyline of Woody being kidnapped by Al from Al's Toy Barn, and Buzz Lightyear leads the group to go rescue Woody. And this is one of the most intense road trip movies for Pixar in general. All the characters in this movie are so entertaining to watch. You got Woody in the Roundup Gang, the introduction to Jesse and Bullseye, the Prospector. And you got our original characters with Buzz, Ham, Rex, the Potato Heads. And just the story is so epic. Everything at Al's Toy Barn is great. That highway scene is great. And Evil Emperor Zurg just... reminiscing the iconic quotes from The Empire Strikes Back. up, just gets you in the emotions, and I don't need to talk much else about the opening 10 minutes of Up as a masterpiece. Let's just get that right out of the way. Carl's storyline, his love for planes and piloting, wanting to take Ellie on an adventure to Paradise Falls, but real life hits you right in the guts in the first 10 minutes with the death of Ellie, and Carl being this old brat and grouchy man, meeting Russell, his son he never had, Kevin, Doug, great animal characters, but I think everybody can agree the third act of Up is pretty cheesy with the talking dogs. I think the animation is gorgeous. The scenery taking place in South America is great. And just a funny film too. Squirrel!
Ladies and gentlemen, it's too much for Mr. Incredible! Whoa, ho, ho!
It's finally ready! You know, I went through quite a few supers to get it worthy to fight you. But man, it wasn't good enough!
The first Incredibles movie is one of the best Pixar movies, and we're talking one of the best. I think it's the first Incredibles film, directed by Brad Bird, who's gone on to do Mission Impossible Ghost Protocol, did The Iron Giant, one of my favorite animated movies. The first Incredibles is the best Fantastic Four movie we have gotten so far. I love this family. I love Bob Parr, I love Elastigirl, Frozone, you have Dash, Violet, Jack-Jack, and you have Syndrome, one of the best Pixar villains to date. A big fan of Mr. Incredible, turned super villain. Syndrome is such a great villain, guys. Very memorable, one of the best parts of the film. Then you just go into this epic superhero showdown, and it's just so fun. And of course, you have Edna Mode. Edna Mode, darling, no capes. Soul, my second time rewatching Soul. I wish I should have seen it more times, but Soul is a masterpiece. It is absolutely brilliant. Pete Docter is a genius for coming up with this film. Just a sad story with Joe Gardner. Jamie Foxx does a brilliant job as the voice character. He is a jazz teacher, and he doesn't really want to be a jazz teacher. He wants to be a jazz musician. But then he's trying to find his purpose, his spark in life, and then he just dies, walks into a porthole, and then is going to the great beyond. He doesn't want to. Then he meets 22, voiced by Tina Fey. Tina Fey's brilliant in this movie. You learn so much things about Soul. It's one of the most creative Pixar films, one of the best animated, and one of the best scores to date. How you have forgotten souls in here. There's a pirate ship, and a lot of this feels similar to Inside Out to some people. I don't. It's a creative world. I love just, you know, Joe Gardner and 22's story in here, 22 really wanting to live. Man, Soul is so deep, it gets you in the feels, especially in the third act with the song playing. Coco may be one of the most relatable Pixar films for me because I was a musician in high school. I play percussion, and Miguel in this movie has a passion for music. He looks up and idolizes his idol, well, actually not his idol, Ernesto de la Cruz, and he wants to be just like him, discovers that he's his grandfather, he's not his grandfather, but his family is totally against him being a musician because of the family past. Then we go to The Day of the Dead, one of the most beautifully animated Pixar films to this date. There is so much you could do with The Day of the Dead. You can make a Pixar series out of it. And then you meet some of my favorite characters. You got Hector. Hector is one of my favorite Pixar characters to date. The arc for him is brilliant. Ernesto de la Cruz, one of the best twist villains out there. He's a monster. His end is perfect with the bell. I just think Coco is one of the most emotional Pixar films to date. With the ending song, I'm very happy Remember Me won the Oscar.
You made it! Go! Go save Riley!
take her to the moon for me, okay?
Inside Out, one of my favorite movies of all time, possibly. Inside Out, I've seen this film so many times. This is the Pixar film right here that I'm still demanding a sequel to. Like, there's so much you could do with the Inside Out world, with Riley's mind, now that she could possibly be older as a teenager. There's so much you could do, but that's another video for another time. But Inside Out, one of the most ambitious, emotional Pixar films. I love how this film dives into emotions with a child. You got joy, sadness, fear, anger, disgust, great lead characters, and diving into Riley's mind. And I love just the concept, the world. Joy and sadness have to get back to headquarters. Without joy and sadness, the most important emotions out of them all. Some people find it overrated. I definitely disagree with that. Inside Out is just a brilliant film. It's a very funny movie, very realistic. Like, it dives into real world problems and emotions.
Find your exit, buddy. Do you have your exit, buddy?
Yes!
Okay, Squirt here will now give you a rundown on proper exiting technique.
Finding Nemo, just one of the best Pixar films that they have put out to date. Again, we're talking about technically best Pixar films. One of the best is Finding Nemo. I love how it's a very simple father-son storyline. You totally understand why Marlin is so overprotective. He's the most overprotective character or father in a movie I've seen. You understand why after what happens to his wife, and he does everything to protect his only child. Every side character, like this is like my favorite like cast is Finding Nemo. I love all these characters with Crush, the sharks, you got the fish tank gang, like everything. The quotes in this movie just keep swimming. P. Sherman 42 Wallaby Way, shark bait, hoo-ha-ha. And this is a movie adults will love too. If they're watching this for the first time, this may be their favorite Pixar film. It's an understandable, relatable film for parents out there. Toy Story 3 is an absolute perfect movie in every way. It has my favorite film ending of all time. Just these characters. If you've grown up with these characters like me, then you'll really resonate with Toy Story 3. The toys just deals with a realistic storyline. Andy's all grown up, like the prospector warned Woody in Toy Story 2. Our characters go through some very intense stakes than I expected. That infirmary scene, my God, that was very dark Pixar. And it has the best Pixar villain. Rest in peace to Ned Beatty as the voice of Lotso Huggenbear. One of the best Pixar villain to date. You understand why Lotso's a villain. He had an owner that abandoned him, and he just runs this Sunnyside daycare like it's the mafia. Like I mentioned before, the ending to this movie may be the greatest film ending of all time. When Andy gives his toys away to Bonnie, just the emotional score that plays, and Andy breaking down every single toy to Bonnie and how much it means to him. But then it gets to Woody, and that's where the tears start to come. Because he says, Woody, he's been my pal for so long, and the thing about Woody that makes him special is that he'll never forget about you. He'll always have your back.
This isn't flying, this is falling with style.
To infinity and beyond!
The film that started it all for Pixar in 1995, the year I was born, Toy Story is a classic. Like, this film is the most rewatchable Pixar film, in my opinion. If this first Toy Story film wasn't good or wasn't successful, Pixar wouldn't exist today. And it's so revolutionary, and I think is a reason to give it that leg up over the other ones, is brilliant. Woody as a character, he's unlikable at the start. Once Buzz Lightyear shows up, he has that ego to him. Like, this new toy shows up, and now he's getting attention from Andy. Andy's my toy. I'm his favorite toy. And I just love this rivalry at the start with Woody and Buzz. This is a film that when I get older, and if I have kids, I'm going to show them this film first, the first Toy Story movie, why Pixar is at where it's at today. And this film is a film that has been passed down to generations and it's easily my favorite Pixar film. There you have it, guys. That was my ranking for all 24 Pixar movies. Again, let me know in the comments below if you agree or disagree. You definitely disagree. Let me know your list down below in the comments, and let's have a polite, respectful conversation. Guys, thank you so much for watching this ranking video. All my social media links are in the description below, and I'll see you guys in the next video. Bye!